today I'm going to talk about the conifold, the mirror symmetry around conifold, especially the flap and its mirror feature on the syntactic side. Let me begin with a conifold first. So the conifold is a three-dimensional singularity defined by the following equation. So x0 is my conifold, and this is defined by this v1, v1 minus u2, v2 equals 0. And this is actually toric. This toric Gerenstein, one of toric Gerenstein singularities, and it admits this toric moment polytop. So this is a cone over a regular rectangle. So this whole part is a moment polytop for x0, and then you can blow it up, so you get a smooth toric manifold. Let's call it x tilde. And then you can contract. So this is p1 cross p1. This rectangle represents p1 cross p1. So you have two curves, c and c prime. And you can contract one of these curves to get small resolutions of this conical. So if you contract c prime, so this is x tilde. Get, let's call it y. So this is contracting c prime. So you have a rational curve c in it. You can contract the other curve, C, you get Y prime. And here you have C prime. It's over the conifold. And so the relation between these two is called a flap. So Y prime is obtained from Y by doing flap. And so you can understand this birational equivalence as a change of stability condition in a way. So first of all, there is a derived equivalence of corresponding derived categories, which I call FM. It's free M guide transform. This is free M guide transform whose kernel is a structure shape of this X tilde. And I call it flap functor. This top is from dby to dby. And today I'm restrict myself to a smaller subcategory of dbx, which consists of a kind of compact object. So I define a smaller category, dx over y over x, so y over x0, which consists of a sheaf such that it's support. As in the rational curve C here. And you can restrict this functor here too. And there's a similar category here, dy prime over x0. And this one is strict to give an equivalence as well. So you have fm. I'll use the same letter, dy x is 0, dy prime over x0. So the typical object of this smaller category is, for example, line bundles or vector bundles over this curve, or skyscraper sheaves of points in this curve C. And this is also equivalent. I'm sorry. This is equivalent, and this is also equivalent. For example, you have OC here. This one goes to a OC prime minus 2 shifted by 1. And
Can you write a little larger and press a little harder?
Yeah, press a little bit more and like right please a little bit larger.
Okay, sorry. So so OC prime, OC minus 1 shifted by 1 goes to OC prime minus. And the reason why I introduced the images of this object will be is because I'm going to be interested in certain hard, certain abelian subcategory here that are generated by this one. So first of all, you can see that this functor, flap functor, is not hard preserving. So it sends some object to a object with a shifting by 1. So, to understand this functor better using stability conditions, is to introduce two different parts. So by bridge length. So he introduced two hearts of certain bounded T structures in this category, which I call covers. So there are two hearts, bounded T structures, which I call covers inverse minus one over y over x zero. Zero y over x zero y prime over y over x zero, and I'm not going to define these two precisely, but in this example, they are generated by, so this is abelian category. This is the extension closure of OC minus one one and OC, and this one. It's extension closure of OC minus 2, 1 and OC minus 1. And then the observation is actually this flop functor swaps these two parts. So there are corresponding hearts on y prime side as well. So covers y prime. So Fm, the flop functor, swaps covers minus 1 per minus 1 and per 0. That means it sends minus 1 per y over x0 to 0 of per y prime x0, and similar for 0 and minus 1. It's kind of swapping these two. And as you can already see here, right, because these two objects generate the per inverse per minus one, and then goes to per zero here. And give you more specific example how this functor behaves using a point object, skyscraper, which is. Example is about skyscraper shape. So you pick a point from C. It's a curve that is contracted by this map, this projection, blow down. And consider a structure shape of this point, the skyscraper shape. Then the fact is that this is actually not a point object. In per inverse x y over x zero. So here, point object in the abelian category means there is a surjection from structure shift to this point in the abelian category. But in fact, the ideal shift of this point is not a perverse. Doesn't belong to this category. This is actually not a point object per minus one. And then so y is actually you can write this as a exact triangle OC minus one one and then one. So this is not a point object in per minus one. If you swap the order of these two and you consider another extension, and that is a point object in per inverse. So if you swap, to switch the order of this cone, of this triangle, you consider a certain object, certain extension by these two, then E is actually a point object per inverse, per minus 1. And so E is actually not a shape, but two-term complexes. So H0 of this guy is OC, and S inverse of this guy is OC minus 1. So this is two-term complex. So this is just, so I call it powers point, because it's a point object in pair minus 1. It's called, just usual point. It's a point object in the derived category of quotient shapes. And then let's send it by Diplock functor. Then by this thing here, it's a flat functor, because flat functor, this functor is a triangulated functor, so it preserves the cone. So what you get on y prime side is this guy, OC minus 2, C prime minus 2, 1, and this one goes to OC prime. OY should go to a cone of this morphism, which is exactly a point shape, point object, just skyscraper shape. Oh, sorry, this is E prime. It's a certain two-term complex. So by this functor, the image of the point object, the skyscraper shape is written two-term complex, looks very similar to this. So in fact, this one belongs to per zero, I guess. This is a point object. This power point. Point object. In fact, this lies in this is point object in zero per y prime over x zero. And if you send this one by flop functor, then you get you just get skyscraper shape. I'm not going to write down the cone. So y prime and c prime. So the observation here is the flop functor actually swaps. Powers point shapes and usual point shapes or skyscraper shapes. So, yeah, let me just phrase it this way. Flat functor swaps powers point in points. So this is the one observation on B side. And now I will quickly move on to A side to see what is the mirror picture of this phenomenon here. So far, we have considered a small resolution of conical, right? A mirror of small resolutions. Mirror of resolution is usually smoothing. So I take a smoothing. Let's consider a smoothing of this guy, which I call x. This is smoothing of x0. It's defined by u1, v1, minus u2, v2. It's some small epsilon, which is non-zero. And there is a work by Chen, Paul Y. Chen, and Comeliano, and Ueda. So they put that actually there are torus vibrations, Lagrangian torus vibrations on X and Y as well, such that they are SYZ dual to each other. So y and x, y is my small resolution of conifold. And these are x, y, z dual. Yeah, in fact, you have to get rid of divisors on both sides. But this looks like caution. You have to get rid of that in. Today's talk, I only consider a smaller subcategory whose support lies in the curve C. So getting rid of divisor doesn't matter that much. So maybe you can just ignore this getting removing divisor part. But yeah. And then I want to first introduce how this torus vibration look like on syntactic side. So you can rewrite x in this way. So x admits a double conic vibration, which makes makes us to see SYZ vibration easier. So you can rewrite this one as u1, v1, u2, v2, and introducing a new variable z, and satisfying two equations. So u1, v1, c minus a for a certain number, u2, v2, c minus a. I choose a and b such that, say, b minus a equals epsilon. And then, as I said here, you have to actually get rid of a certain divisor as equals zero. And this is actually a little different from x, but as I said earlier, because I'm only considering objects who support light in some small compact region, so this will be enough. I just call it x, the same notation, although they are a little different. And This guy, X, admits a very nice vibration, a double conic vibration. So you look at a Z projection. Z projection. I draw the image here. So this is Z plane. And then a generic fiber of this G projection is double conic, right? So if you fix Z, here in this equation, and you have conic times conic. So if you pick like some random point, generic point, then you have a like cotangent bundle of S1 times itself. But over A or over B, you have singular fibers. So over A, over B, over B. The singularity types are a little different because in over A you have a singular conic times a smooth conic, and over B you have now like they're switched. So you have smooth conic first and then singular conic. This is the Z plane. Let me redraw it. I don't have enough space to that work. Again, this is the Z plane. And then you have two singular fibers. And remember, I removed divisor Z equals zero. So you have one puncture here, Z equals zero. And torus vibration can be seen easily in this picture. So you take a circle centered at the origin. And over each point of this circle, you have a double conic, conic times conic, and you choose a section like this. And if this section has constant height all over along the circle, then you have a special Lagrangian torus. So that's how CPU defined. It's called CPU. So Chan Pomelian of Rueda defined a torus vibration. And the more interesting object, at least to me, is this sphere, which is supposed to be a mirror to a curve C on B side. So why this is sphere? I show you some more topological picture. So remember, I have a singular conic times a smooth one. And here you have a smooth one times singular conic. And then you consider kind of vanishing cycle. So here, you have this Lagrangian in one vector times another one. I should have called it thimble, but anyway. So you can consider this Lagrangian, which is fiber product over this path. This is a sphere because, for example, you can take the middle torus. You see that one of the circle strings to a point here. So this half, the left half of this picture is represent the solid torus. Because this is like this kind of circle. And on the other side, the other circle string to a point. So this is another solid torus. So this is somehow a three sphere. It's a union of two solid torus, a solid tori. So this is a sphere. I call it S1. This is a Lagrangian sphere. And you have lots of spheres because you can, for example, you can take something like this, the vanishing symbol over this path. And I call it S0. And this way, you have lots of spheres. Or the easier way to see this is you draw a cylinder instead of a C star in this way. So you identify these two, then you just C star like this, right? That's called, this is zero direction. This is infinity direction. Then you have this path here. And let me just draw some more copies. It's kind of a covering space of this guy. And then, for example, you also have this. S1, S0 is this guy. This is S1. S0 is this guy. But in fact, as you can see here, there are lots of spheres with different slopes. For example, you can take this, or this, whatever. And torus fibers are like straight lines here. So although I'm not going to write down, but there is some specific holomorphic volume form, which makes all these straight lines special. So special Lagrange is, in this example, just geodesics on Z-plane. But there could be more, but I'm interested in such Lagrangians, such special Lagrangians. So omega is chosen such that these are our special. They're special. These are special. And what Chan, Pomeliano, and Ueda proved is the following theorem by CPU. Is the they considered a soft sky category generated by S0 and S1. Let's give a name. Maybe that's called a subcategory generated by S0, S1. F, call it F. Maybe drive after drive. And then what CPU has proved is this F is actually equivalent to our category D Y over X0. So remember, this consists of quaternion shapes whose support lies in the curve C. So on the object level, so S0 should go to C minus 1, 1, and S1 should go to OC, if I remember correctly. And yeah, this is equivalent. Okay. So now this one can be you can perform some kind of fluff. So there's a fluff functor from this guy to some other guy. Y prime X0. This is fluff functor. And then I want to find a mirror picture of this fluff functor on this side. So for this, I introduce you some operation on this manifold X. So let's look at a moduli space of such smoothings. It's kind of complex moduli. So let's draw some plane. So this is different from C-plane there. So over a point, over point epsilon, say, prime, you have U1, V1, minus U232 constituent. So let's consider this moduli space of smoothings of conifold. And over zero, you have a conifold. Right? This is conifold point. And my x lies over b minus a. And yes, we have x here. It's certain volume form. And then I take another fiber for this vibration, which lies over a minus b. And then I'll move from here to here by a certain path that avoids the conifold singularity. So over here, you have x prime. So if you switch b minus a to a minus b, then this double conic vibration, the effect in this double conic vibration picture is you just swap index 1 and index 2. So this one becomes c minus b, and this one will become c minus a at this on this x prime. This, so going from here to here is just swapping u1, v1, and u2, v2. So you just swap the coordinate, so you also have some volume form here. And now I want to look at some kind of symplectomorphism from x to x prime. So how do I construct this symplectomorphism? So define a symplectomorphism by x to x prime, or to be generated by a certain rotation. So you originally have this sphere S1. Then over here you have something singular times smooth times singular. Then you pick a point, maybe a midpoint, and do a rotation. And if you do half rotate, then you reach it at this point. So if you do a pi rotation, then this triangle goes here and circle goes here. Okay. And then now this one becomes smooth times singular. Singular time smooth. So this is actually exactly x prime. So kind of role of A and B are switched. The singularity ties are switched. So I can write this down in terms of coordinate, and you can check that actually if you do it twice, then it's a dentwist along this guy. But anyway, let's use this symplectomorphism to see the mirror picture of cloud. Flap hunter. So I have this symplectomorphism. And, I forgot to say one thing. So you have this rotation along a near sphere, and then you have to cut off. So this operation is kind of local near the sphere. Yes. The effect is that maybe it's easier to look at this cylinder picture. I think I'm drawing too many pictures. I mean, you have this. So originally you have this. This is my S0, S1, and S0, and so on. And you perform this operation, and in the middle, you see this moment where they align in the vertical line. All together. And then if you do all the way to pi rotation, then this guy will become like this. You have to keep track of orientation, so you orient it passing this way. Then here. So remember, this flap functor sends OC minus 1, 1 to OC prime minus 1, OC to OC prime minus 2, 1. So roughly speaking, this flap functor is kind of shifting. So shifting means on chi side is kind of orientation, taking orientation reversal. And for these two pair, it's kind of winding number changes. So you can see this effect here. So S0 seems to go to the same object, but the orientation is reversed. And this guy, S1, has a different winding number. You can phrase it more rigorously, but let me just say it in this way. And this moment where all the spheres lies on this vertical line, this is actually the wall, because all the spheres, S0 and S1, will have the same phase. So, the phase in this picture is just a slope of this straight line. So, the theorem is, this is joint work with Fan, Lau, and Yao. The theorem is I have this category F generated by spheres, and another category F prime on this side, also generated by spheres. And there's this morphism or functor induced by symplectomorphism. And here we have this dx y over x0, dy prime over x0, and this is a flat functor. And this is again CPU, Chan Meliano Ueda. This is a CPU. And they commit. This is one observation. And I promised you to show you the swapping of Hubbard's point and point object. So let me quickly draw one more picture and move on to a slightly different story. So what happened to the point object when you do this operation? So let's look at this picture again. This is my S0 and S1. And point object, in this case, is by SYZ duality, is simply a torus fiber. So you look at torus fiber that intersects this sphere. So let's take any, for example. And you perform the operation again. So this is the mirror of skyscraper shape, O1, by SYZ duality, mirror symmetry. And then you do rotation, half rotation, and now you end up in this picture. So S0 goes to almost itself, and this one becomes like this. And torus fiber will be very ugly. Something like this. So remember, OY goes to a powers point, right? This flat functor has points and powers points. So OY, it goes to, this is this side. The mirror picture is, you get some Hubbard's points, which is the cone of these two guys, dysmorphism. And these two, in the mirror side, nothing but these two spheres. And you see that the Hubbard's point, this side should correspond to this torus, because you can obtain this torus by taking surgery at these two points, this angle. But in fact, the proof involves a little more, because I'm not so sure how this mapping cone story in category, how general it is. So the actual proof is, one remark is, when you prove this is cone given in this way on the mirror side, so this is, maybe a better write it. This is, I think, the image of S0. So let's call it S0 and S0 prime and S1 prime. This is S1 prime and S1. Oh, sorry. Yeah, right. This one should be S1 prime. So the proof is actually I found, so you consider two objects like the mapping cone of certain morphism from S0 prime to S1 prime. And on the other hand, you look at this torus, and I found the isomorphism between them explicitly. So you find, you want to say this is cone, this is a cone of certain morphism. So proof is, okay, let me just put it this way. The proof is actually find isomorphism. Okay, okay. So I'm not saying I can obtain this by exergy, so this should be a cone. All right, let me, yeah, so this is how we see this flap on A side using SYZ picture, so how torus fibers behaves under this syntax morphism and so on. Now, instead of considering SYZ meter, I want to look at a meter given from the a former deformation theory of certain Lagrangian. And that will give you a non-commutative deformation, a non-commutative resolution of conic fold. So now I do a formal deformation of a certain immersed Lagrangian that is simply the union of those two spheres, S0 and S1. So by formal deformation, I meant you deform the A-infinite algebra, CFLL, in an algebraic way. So how does it look like, first of all? It has like several components. You have endomorphism, because L is a direct sum of two objects. You have endomorphism of SI, and you have Hong from 0 to 1, and you have Hong from 1 to 0. And the A-infinite structure on this algebra is very is well known. You can use any models in Abu Jai's plumbing paper, or in fact, CPU Chan from Eliana Ueda has already computed this explicitly. Or you can use per trajectories, or yeah, any model you like. Yes. So yeah, how many generators are here? So I'm going to deform this A-infinite algebra only by degree one element, and this is sphere, so it only has degree zero and degree three. So this not my concern, but S0 and S1, their intersection are clean. So they're intersecting along a circle. So you turn slightly, and you pick up two intersection points over this point. So you play, so pick up two more points here. So if you perturb them so that they are transversal to each other, then you have four different intersection points, which I call X, Y, it's 2 degree one intersection and two, which I call C bar. Degree two, these are degree two. So degree one and degree two. The reason why I take this bar notation is this is actually a Poincare dual to ones without bar. So you have degree 2 degree one elements here, 2 degree two elements here. And again, it's, for example, X and X bar, Poincare dual. There's a natural pair. These are degree one. And I take as deformation parameter, I take the linear combination of these four. So I take linear combination, all possible linear combination that gives degree one. Take XX, YY, and ZZ. And here are the small variables, x, y, z, w, are just free variables. So a priori, they don't have to have any relation among them. It's a free day. At this moment, when I'm going to solve certain equations which impose a relation between those variables. So I have to solve this equation. And then we solve a so-called Mara-Cartan equation, which is in an infinite setting, it's M1D. M0 is 0, so it's hard for M1D. M1D is 0, M2BD. Plus N3DBD. You do this to infinite, and you want this to be 0. So if you have B, which satisfies this equation, then you can deform this infinite algebra by inserting B to MK operation in every possible positions. And so these are all graded settings. Those are all graded Lagrangians. And so sometimes people look at the weak Mara-Cartan equation, which the right-hand side, in that case, is replaced by something times identity. But this is graded setting, so it's impossible because the left-hand side is already graded, degree 2. So this is the only meaningful deformation, in a way. And let's just solve this equation. So I compute all this k. And so the other parts are either zero or tensored. I think M2 is only classical, so if you do what I mean by this free variable, I'm sorry. My convention is, if you encounter this kind of expression, then the convention is you pull back, pulling out the coefficient from the back. So you pull out z first, and yz, and m3, xyz. So you get another some monomial in a free algebra, but this one can be is well defined. You just do a usual m3 operation on the concavity. So that's what I mean by this Mara-Cartan equation, or solving Mara-Cartan equation. So the upshot is, if you compute that, then what you get is, let me just call it M2BD. It's M1B plus M2BD plus. And you only have an M3 contribution. So all other are canceled. So this one is, for example, you have XYZ minus CYX. W bar. So W bar is degree 2 generator from the other side. Oh, on the same side, so. On the left side. And you have three more terms, and three more, which is symmetric to this guy. So you just commit XYZ in a cyclic way to get three other terms. And for this, you have to count a Paul trajectory. For example, you have after you perturb S0 and S1, you can see, for example, strip and some isolated gradient flow, another strip, and here you have X and say Y, and Z, and the output is W bar. So input is X, Y, Z, and output is W bar. So this one should contribute to, I think, the first one. So yeah, I'm not going to show you the detailed computation. Okay. So by doing so, the conclusion is the space of the Mara-Cartan elements, space of MC elements, is nothing but the following quiver with a relation with potential. So so you have two vertices, which represent S0 and S1. So I just label it 0 and 1. And the arrows, X goes to, these arrows represent degree 1 morphisms. And I attach small variable X. Yes, I see. I think I made a terrible mistake here. It should be C. I'm sorry. My notation, this is XC X bar. So it should be XC. And the other way, I have Y and W. And the relation I want to impose is exactly like this to be zero, so that big mark, Markov equation is really zero. With XYZ equals CY. And three more. Or the simpler way to write down this idea or this relation is, this is actually a Jacobian ideal of certain cyclic elements, where P is so let's call this quiver Q, and quiver with potential Q and phi, which simply means you take path edge from this guy and divide this by Jacobian ideal way, or this guy, or these relations. This is well known to be a non-commutative resolution of cone. This is non-commutative. Crappan resolution of conical at zero. And in fact, if you only look at the loop space at zero, you have, for example, CY, XW, XY, so on. You have four loops, and they satisfy conical relation. This kind of, this is a resolution. So you embed these four loops into here. It's a resolution. So anyway, this is non-commutative Crappan resolution of conical. And so you have formal deformation space of Lagrangian sphere, or union of Lagrangian sphere. And by the by earlier work of myself with Cha Hyun Cho and Xu Cheng Lau, we have an infinite functor. So you have an infinite functor. The upshot is you have an infinite functor. Which I call psi. From F. So remember, F is a derived category, a derived chi category generated by a zero and S1. I think I should say it's triangulated. Because everything is derived. Here you have D, that's a Q module, DB, or this Kiver representation. Maybe I call the Kiver algebra by A, it's a path algebra of this Kiver divided by rotation. We have one. And, yeah, in fact, you can check that the image of this functor should lie in an important element. That means some complex whose cohomology is a Neopotent module over N. So if you have to, yeah, I don't think this is standard rotation, but the image falls into Neopotent kind of modules. And then you can think that this is actually an equivalence. And then let me try to see this like stability related picture using this functor. And right. So on A side, I have a bunch of special objects, a bunch of spheres of porous. I didn't define this functor. So for example, if you have Lagrangian L, then the image of this guy is simply taking four cohomology with my reference Lagrangian at zero union is one. With L, it has differential, this is complex, which is M1B. And then you can use M2BB and so on to extend this functor to be an infinite functor. And let's compute this for several objects. So for example, S0 and S1 are sent to vertex simples, like you have two vertex, 0 and 1, and you have C and 0 for C theorems. It's just floor cohomology computation. Oh, sorry. This is after I'm taking M1, taking homology. And of course, complex itself could be complicated. But if you do M1D cohomology, then you get either this one or this one. And torus. Then yes, torus. The torus could be a little more complicated because T involves some discounting. So torus, remember, torus looks like this. Sits in this way, in this cylinder picture. It's S0. Oh, sorry. This is S0 and S1. And then if take a torus looks like this. So this is cylinder, so you identify these two, then you get circle. Lines lying over it is a torus. And to compute the image of the torus, you have to do counting, the holomorphic disk counting. And you see here some non-constant holomorphic disks. So it's a bit more complicated, but not very much. So the image is for that I used per trajectory. I counted per trajectories, and what you get is CNC. It's over 0 and 1, so you have this paper here. So this again, this is M1B cohomology. And then you have arrows from here to here. And the other arrows are 0. So you only have these two maps. Multiplying A and B, where this ratio depends on the relative area and certain holomorphs over this torus fiber. So in fact, you can see this parameterizes. From A side, this A ratio between A and B parameterizes the torus fibers that intersect here. And on B side, you can think of it as a point in C by SYZ duality. So torus goes to this kind of object. Or you can compute even more complicated one. For example, you can tell slope M here. This looks like slope minus M. This is also sphere. And you do like similar computation that involves some more discounting. This one gives you the direction should be here. Yes. Something like this. After taking cohomology again. Here, these are like C to D, I guess, n plus 1. And you can do a slope minus n series too. And the stable object on this side is classified. So let's go back to this side just for a second. B side, we have this cube. And you attach a number, C0, from Z1. And here, Z0 and Z1 are center charges of S0 and S1, which are in the upper half plane. And if you fix these two numbers, then you get a center charge for the cube representation. This is simply the inner product between like this vector with a dimension vector. So you have center charge. And this center charge will gives you some stable object, and stable objects are classified. Yeah. So with this center charge, so first of all, if you define center charge in this way, then it's easy to see that this functor is kind of center charge preserved in math. And on this side, classifications are so all this, let's call it the statement is both are all of these are stable. Here, all of this means this representation on the right hand side coming from Lagrangian spheres or Lagrangian torus fibers. And in fact, there are some missing. The mark is stable object. Stables are classified by Agawa and Nakajima. And in their classification result, something. So we didn't get all of them because in their classification they also have this, like C and C, but arrow runs in both directions. So you have A and B, but you could have like C D with one of these is non-zero. But you see that this is actually not important because, for example, if you compose these two, then you can loop, and you can multiply this loop infinitely many times. So in their classification, there is a certain thing that we can't achieve in this way, but those are not in B-side category in our person. This one, quick remark. And let's perform this operation again. Oh, sorry. Right. Another remark is in B-side. So you look at a stable object, and there are two chambers. And let's call zeta I to be the argument of ci. And there are two chambers. Of these parameters as ci. And one chamber is C0 is smaller than zeta 1, which is this case. So C, the slope of this guy is smaller than the slope of this guy. So what I computed here is on this chamber. And the other chamber is the other way around. So let me perform the rotation here. We do half rotation, then this guy goes like this. And this guy, S0, goes to this. So now you see this one has bigger slope. Okay? So, so from here to here is actually on A side, it's half rotation, and then, so I don't have enough time. Okay, so after half twist, after applying pi star, the half twist, half rotation, you can get stable in the other chamber, in this chamber. This one is for the previous. Now you have this. The other. Yeah. So, yeah, maybe, yeah, try here. Maybe.